2020 will undoubtedly go down in history as one of the most challenging years for humans and businesses. Fast forward to 2021 and hope is on the horizon. COVID-19 vaccine rollouts will certainly help the world return to some kind of normal, but the world of work has undoubtedly changed forever. I spoke to Vivek Wadhwa about innovating resilience and the tactics being deployed by tech giants to future-proof themselves and their people in the never normal. I can imagine that all of this change that's happening at breakneck speed is incredibly daunting. So I just wanted to get your perspective in terms of how people can actually, one, break through the hype, and two, then try and reassess and take stock of the situation to come out of it stronger and better.
Yeah. Yes, see, if you go back a year and a half, people didn't believe that you could have a virus, you know, mutating and bringing humanity to its knees. You had the presidents of, government leaders, prime ministers and presidents saying, poo-poo, it'll go away. It's nothing. I mean, it'll disappear. They didn't understand exponentials, right? The exponentials happened. The virus spread and it basically brought us to our knees, literally. It decimated economies and did worldwide damage. In the United States alone, we've lost 500,000 human beings because of this, right? So this is how exponentials go. That you may not understand them, but they're happening. And as I said, technology is advancing exponentially. You got to understand it. And this is why I wrote these two books, that they're written so that anyone can understand them. The driving the driverless car explains all the basics and talks about the ethical issues. The theme of the book is it's all about how, what you said about us not understanding, what I argue is that we better understand, because we have to tell our politicians what should be law. I mean, laws are codified ethics. Ethics are a consensus that builds our society over time. When we don't even understand these technologies, how do we know what's ethical? So the only way we'll come to that consensus is by learning. There's not only the HR directors, it's their children, their parents, their spouses who must learn and start having discussions and debates about what's right and what's wrong.
From your perspective, and given your track record in the business world, how do you think the leaders of today and tomorrow should be leveraging technology to build trust?
Yes, what I see is there's a difference between leaders. I mean, I've spoken to many British leaders, many American leaders who are very highly ethical, who have good values, who will do the right things. And then there are others who will abuse it, basically who will clamp down on the label, already companies spy on their employees, right? So some leaders will basically want to create a surveillance state within their own companies. Really, it's for the employees now to understand what's good and what's bad, to come to a consensus and tell their bosses what is right, what is wrong. This is the role of the HR department, to convey to the executive team exactly what is acceptable and what's ethical and what's legal. So, the folks on this podcast better start learning this stuff, because you can't hide from it. If you hide from it, you're going to basically become its victim. It's like pretending that the virus isn't going to spread. Hey, it can't happen to us. We don't need to wear masks. It's someone else's problem. It's a hoax. It's a hoax. No, it's not a hoax. Technology is advancing exponentially. And there are many, many, many ethical issues and challenges that are going to face our personal lives, our work lives, and our societies. You better start participating in them. Let's assume that, we're a year from now when things are more normal. So you have some employees who want to work from home. So to not have to come to work saves them 2 hours of commute time, mm-hmm. right? It saves them transportation costs, and it gives them a lot more convenience to be able to do other things. Now, even though they may have the same skills as people who come to work, is it fair that they make the same amount of money? We could argue that they should take a slightly less money. And I think most people would agree to that. If I had a choice of being able to work from home 3 or 4 days a week and take, a proportionate, maybe 10% less salary, I'd probably do it. And it would be fair to other people, because then people at work wouldn't feel left out about me, working from home and them not working from home. It's a choice I made based on an economic, because they would have a valid argument here. That they're spending so much time and energy and effort and money to come to work. Why should, Sheila be allowed to work from home when John isn't? So those are the type of debates we could be having.
Yeah, no, I think I totally see your point. I just kind of, it brings me around my whole
I think a lot of people out there in this day and age are really suffering with the notion of like remote working, because ultimately I feel like doing it during a global pandemic, it's not necessarily doing remote working right. A lot of people feel ultimately that they're living at work as opposed to working from home. And I also think that that comes with a renewed, a heightened need for leaders to kind of take stock of the situation and ultimately really think about how they set boundaries, because mental well-being and burnout are really, you know, rife throughout the pandemic. So I also wonder from your perspective, I know you've led businesses and sold businesses, you know, when it comes to looking at your workforce and also yourself as a leader and an individual, how can you use technology to build resilience?
You know, that's a really good question. On the pandemic, I think as soon as this is all over, we're all going to want to get back to work because we're going to be fed up of working from home. But then what's going to happen is it's going to be a hybrid situation. So you talk about how will technology be used? We'll have, you know, look at how we're using technology right now. We're having a very, you know, a great conversation. We're sharing it with thousands of people, right? So this is a use of technology, social media and all of the other new tools for working from home. The fact that all the information now is on the cloud, that it's accessible. So you can literally, you can work from anywhere. As we've seen during the pandemic, you can be anywhere now and work. So these are the type of things which technology is making possible. Mm-hmm. Now, the problem again is what you said, the work-life balance, that it's no longer, you know, working from home. It's really being, your home has become work now. So therefore, I think that we're going to now have to have a balance here, that for most employees, you give them the option of working from home a couple of days a week. And if they want more than that, then they take a slight salary cut. That's my solution to it. That's what I would do if I was CEO. I'd work with my HR people and come up with, you know, an equitable formula so that everyone considers it fair. And then I tell the company, look, here what the new rules are, that you can, because then it's good for me because it saves me some money. And it's good for the employees because it lets them adjust their lifestyle. They don't have to live next to the office anymore. They don't have to live, you know, in the expensive places they live to shorten their commute. They can live in Bermuda if they want to. God knows they can live anywhere as long as they, you know, adjust their time zones.
Yeah, so I'm definitely up for moving to Bermuda, by the way. I don't have a problem with that. It's way nicer than I imagine than London. And, you know, when you think back to your career and all the amazing businesses that you've built and also your experience and immersion in the technology industry, for you as a leader and giving everything that you know, how do you think leaders can actually foster a culture of innovation in 2021?
Yeah. Innovation happens now through the crowd, basically. It's, you know, it's everyone in the company has a role in innovation. That's what I explain in the book. And I explain how you know, how it works. So the concept I had in mind that I proposed really is that you open source all the data from all, because when you do clinical trials, it's protected by the industry and it's not shared. So yeah, these hundreds of thousands of data points we get, we're going to make it available to people all over the world. So it's going to be people like you who suddenly, you know, see some data points and come up with some great insights. You know, we basically bring different parts of the company together. We now start sharing our priorities and challenges and get people collaborating in ways we've never done before. That's how you innovate. That's what the magic happens, through people. And everyone in the company has a role to play in innovation. They provide different insights. And when you have radically different ideas coming together, the magic begins to happen. That's the secret of Silicon Valley. It's a giant cauldron of people from all over the world with diverse ideas who share them with one another. And suddenly you've got the most innovative place on this planet. That's how the system works. And that's what companies have to do also, is stop, turning to your experts and your gurus and your R&D people. Turn to the masses, turn to your people. You'll find that productivity rises, morale rises when you get people involved in solving big problems.
So for you, actually, it's kind of like the equation problem, and correct me if I'm wrong, it's technology empowering the individual, and that's when you start seeing true innovation and a boost in productivity.
Exactly. I mean, you also have to have those people understand technologies. You also have to bring them together in the right ways. You've got to have, you've got to facilitate the discussions and so on. There's other things, you know, they need to be done, but if you do those, you can build the most innovative companies on this planet.
Do you think that the current situation has opened our eyes in terms of how or to which extent humans are resilient? And also with that in mind, do you think we're now better prepared to deal with the next exponential threat, or do we still have lots to learn?
Yesterday was a shock to the whole system. Everyone all over the world was caught off guard, right? So yes, we've learned the hard way. Now the question, will the lesson stick? I don't know, because what I fear is that 6 months from now, everyone gets vaccinated and we throw off our mask and we pretend it never happened. And we get back into our state of denial. If that happens, then we're going to be taken by the next shock and the next shock after that. So what I'd rather have happen is to have people now come out of this experience, realize that exponential change is happening. We could be caught off guard. It's time now to realize the opportunities and the threats and to build a better world.
Also interesting on that note as well is the fact that, Bill Gates has been saying that a pandemic would break out and that the world was nowhere near ready where it needed to be in order to deal with it. So why do you think that sometimes when, tech CEOs, futurists, innovators are actually coming out and sending these messages based on the data and the expertise and the insight that they have, why are they ignored?
Yes, in the first edition of Driving the Driverless Car, which came out in 2017, I believe, I also talked about the possibility of a pandemic through bioengineered viruses. Okay, the book talked about what's possible, and I also talked about that, because when you look at the pieces, you see what's possible. So Bill Gates is simply looking at all of the data and saying, oh my God, this could happen. So what people like Bill Gates can do is they can see trends. He gets to look at it from a very high point of view, from a high altitude, and look at all the pieces coming together, and it becomes obvious. And that's what, the point I'm making is that it's not a special skill that he has. You were able to do the same. You were able to now, you've written on many, many, many topics, but you were able to now look at the trends and put the pieces together and say, oh my God, this is what's possible. Because you've written on such a broad set of topics by being an independent observer.
I think that's really important ultimately, because I think that sometimes people in their day-to-day jobs, we get caught up in the detail and we get distracted by administrative tasks, which I guess speaks to how ultimately, automation and AI is going to liberate the workforce from like menial tasks and so on. But it seems to me like there's an increasing need to actually focus on the bigger picture and think about the role that we play within a team, within a company, and also within the wider economy.
Exactly. I have nothing to add to that.
Great. Well, there I go. That's my soundbite for today. Before we go, I also just wanted to get your insight in terms of Silicon Valley, which is something that you've mentioned time and time again. And I know it's a place that you've been immersed in yourself. Clearly, big tech sometimes has a really bad reputation for the obvious reasons. And sometimes it's, fair, sometimes it's unfair, but obviously that's up for debate. But if you think about some of the biggest tech businesses in the world today, where do you think some of them are going right in terms of, being resilient and actually thinking about how they empower their workforce to come out stronger and better?
Yes, see, I live in the heart of Silicon Valley. In fact, I live on a hill and I can see Silicon Valley from my deck. So, and I've also been very critical about some companies. As many as people are my friends. I mean, the CEOs of some of the largest companies, I used to hold Mark Zuckerberg and Sheryl Sandberg in very high regard because they promised to change the world and make it a better place. And for a while, Facebook was doing incredible things. But then what happened was that money and power corrupted. Mm-hmm. And sadly, that's what happens too often. So what's the role of HR over here? To try to rein them in, to keep them grounded. I mean, I know it's very hard, but the fact is that if HR isn't going to do it, who's going to do it? It's your job to keep your finger on the pulse of the company, to keep people motivated, and to advise the executive team on what's right and what's wrong, what's ethical and what's not ethical. If you don't do it, who will?
The other thing I wanted to get your perspective on is, so I've been covering M&A activity in the AMA in the tech sector for years. Now, there was a story earlier this week that said something around, Tim Cook from Apple was basically saying, how Apple acquires a company every 3 weeks. And we all know that that happens, and it happens quietly because ultimately they want to snap up the competition and, birth out bigger and better companies from themselves. But I just wonder, do you think the pandemic or the post-pandemic Has it supercharged the technology arms race when it comes to mergers and acquisitions? And if so, do you think HR tech will play a role in that at all?
Yes, I didn't come here to promote my book, but from incremental to exponential, the message of the book is that it used to be that David was a threat to Goliath. In other words, these startups could be a threat to legacy companies. Now, Goliath eats David for lunch.
Mm-hmm.
These companies simply buy up whatever they want to buy up. Startups don't have a chance against the incumbents anymore. If the incumbents understand new innovation methods, the majority of the incumbents are going to be out of business because they're stuck in the past. They're in denial about the pace of change, and they're not adjusting their practices to new innovation methods. They're still doing things the old way. But the few, every company I mentioned in that book, this book was written before the pandemic. Every company I mentioned in it thrived in the pandemic because those are the ones I had examples of. Microsoft, Zoom, Logitech, NextEra Energy in Florida, because their leaders were able to understand exponential curves and see the future. So HR tech, there's some incredible technologies out there. And the companies need to start picking and choosing which of them are in line with their vision and which will help them now get to, to redo their innovation methods and adjust their, adapt their companies to the new world we're in. A lot of the HR legacy, HR legacy technologies should be thrown in the garbage. There are a lot of newer technologies that are out there which could help companies work a lot more effectively and efficiently and upgrade their processes.
I totally agree. And also that was just the reason why I was nodding along was because I was just thinking about how the world has changed, but also, with the rise of remote working and the hybrid workplace and whatever that looks like, one of the biggest challenges for HR teams, I imagine, is also compliance. How do you ensure that you're working in a way that's, fitting in with regulation and law, et cetera? And also then, how do you look for technology tools that allow you to do that at scale? Because when you talk about organizations of thousands of people, it's you need software that's agile and adapts to your needs as a business. I wonder whether you had any insight on that as well.
No, what I would say is that if you're clinging onto your legacy systems simply because they worked for you in the past, you might be putting yourself at a disadvantage. Look at the newer technologies and see, what can help you adapt to the new business needs. So you got to be open-minded about all this.
When it comes to resiliency, and I know I'm slightly obsessed with it, but I think it's a really important topic for our audience, bearing in mind where the world is at currently, etc. Do you think some countries are more resilient than others?
Some countries, it really depends on the leadership of those countries. In the UK, you had, the government first being in a state of denial about mm-hmm. the pandemic and not doing anything. And then suddenly the prime minister got it himself and he came back, reinvented with a new religion and so on. But that's how it's been in many, many countries, that they've gone through different phases. So it takes a number of things to get them to become resilient. And part of it is for becoming personal for them, for them now learning the hard way that if they keep denying the science, keep denying the changes that are happening, they may not live very long.
And humanizing is such a great word, because I often feel like people forget that work is about people, and entrepreneurship, there's some great names out there, yourself included, people that have worked incredibly hard and are really making an impact in their chosen field and whatnot. But I think also sometimes other people forget, people like me who look at it from the outside in, we forget that, you're humans, and, people like big CEOs of big multi-technology companies all over the world, they're often treated as celebrities, but I think it's also portrayed as a very glamorous life. But again, it's all about humanizing that function and realizing.
Yes, I tell you, I know many, many billionaires. I know the CEOs of many of the largest companies in the world. They're, I call some of them my friends. I call some of them my ex-friends. The fact is, they're just human beings like you and me. They're deeply flawed.
When you think about some of the world's, some of the leaders in today's business, and whether it's HR, technology, or whatever the industry, is there anybody that stands out to you and that you look up to and you think, yes, that person is thinking about the future in the right way?
I'll talk from a leadership point of view. Satya Nadella is someone I deeply admire. When you look at mm-hmm. the CEOs of companies, why? Because when Satya Nadella took over Microsoft, he inherited it from Steve Ballmer, who was a ruthless, cutthroat sales guy. I mean, if you look at his videos, craziness. I mean, Bill Gates for a while was good. Then he turned into Darth Vader. I mean, this is the same story. It keeps happening. And then, after he handed over the reins, he's now become a humanitarian again. He came to his senses again. But for a while, Gates was called the evil, Microsoft was called the evil empire.
Mm-hmm.
That's what Satya Nadella had inherited. Now, rather than focusing on technology, Satya realized it was a matter of culture, that he had to focus on his people and change the way his people did things, change the way the company. I have an entire case study in incremental to exponential on Satya Nadella and how he decided that he was going to transform the culture of the company first, and then technologies would come second. So he started focusing on now, ethics and values. He started focusing on diversity. He started focusing on bringing people together. He cut out the cutthroat competitive assets. He said, we're not going to be obsessing over protecting one technology over the other. We're going to cooperate not only with each other, we're going to cooperate with our customers. And more importantly, we're going to cooperate with the industry. He turned Microsoft into a company that's considered to be good. You see, Microsoft also has $1 trillion value. It's also doing extremely well, yet no one criticizes Microsoft. When is the last time you had Satya Nadella showing up for a hearing in Capitol Hill, being called evil or being grilled, like we've seen with Google and Facebook and Amazon? It hasn't happened. Microsoft is considered to be a good company. Why? Because of Satya's core values, that he's a good human being. I send emails to him. It may take him 2 or 3 days to respond, but he responds. He's respectful, right? And who am I? And nothing, right? Now, I'm cheating here because I was introduced to him by a friend, a few years ago, and he's read some of my work. But the fact is that he treats me as an equal. He treats me with respect. That's how he treats everyone else in the company and outside the company. He treats them with respect. It's leaders like that I look up to.